Most materials have way less strength in the z-axis along the layer lines compared to the strength in the x and y directions. Meanwhile, PETG excels at this aspect. But regular PETG filaments have to be printed quite slowly as they challenge even modern high flow hot ends, and doing otherwise, the prints turn into a crumbling mess. This is where the new Polymaker's PETG high speed filament comes into play, and their claims are quite bold. So today we are testing this new filament in both a simple and a proper way. By testing low adhesion and print warping with low and high fan speeds, material shrinkage, required extrusion force, water absorption, general printability, and comparing it to my current go-to PETGs. I can tell you, you won't be disappointed with this one. Opening the box, I already love what I see. Unlike others, Polymaker's high-speed PETG comes inside an aluminum resealable bag. All PETG filaments are moisture sensitive, so not shipping in such a bag means it will soak up moisture much quicker. To determine if that is actually a problem, I run a simple test where I extrude and look at oozing the fully dried filament versus one that was kept in water for 1 hour. The more water it absorbs, the more oozing there will be due to evaporating moisture building up higher pressure inside the hot end. As you can see, all PETGs ooze very little when dry and a lot when moist. So a proper bag to ship this type of filament is an aluminum one. So for this category, only Polymaker gets a pass. Before any of the prints, I do flow and pressure advance calibrations to make sure we're getting as much as possible an apples to apples comparison. All filaments were dried according to my drying temperatures and times. Weakness along the layers is the main downside of 3D printing. So to test it with as much accuracy as possible, I really wanted to upgrade my tensile strength testing machine. That meant almost a complete redesign. This time I printed a new part from Bambola PPA CR filament, as this is the most rigid material that I have ever used. Plus, the parts don't warp as they do with regular PA12 CR filaments. However, the star of the show was the parts manufactured by today's video sponsor, PCBWay. These had to be made from a durable and strong tooled steel, as it requires thin edges for the bearing stack. These sections will absorb all the forces during tensioning and breaking, so they must be strong. If you also want to realize your projects in a simple way with many manufacturing options, check them out with the link in the video description. With a machine assembled and a couple of tests done, I was thrilled and could proceed with the testing. I always print PETG enclosed, so during all my testing, the chamber temperatures were at 40 degrees Celsius. I designed the test samples to be representative of real prints. They have thick top and bottom sections of three walls and two in the middle for the consistent breaking points. However, during this testing, both regular PETG variants from Fiberology and Sunlo showed quite a concerning trend. Some samples just deformed and some exploded into multiple pieces in the beefed up sections. Meanwhile, Polymaker's high-speed PETG had a very similar adhesion level and didn't suffer from any of those problems. This means this filament will produce strong prints that you can rely on, which is the first huge advantage of it. I already showed that even PLA filaments can suffer from excessive print cooling in the past, so it is not surprising that blasting the fan at full speed on PETG significantly reduced the adhesion. The interesting part here is that modern PETGs have lost to the regular ones in this comparison, so if you will be printing these filaments, especially on an open type printer, use low cooling settings to maintain maximum adhesion. Cooling can also be a huge factor for print warping, which can lead to dimensional inaccurate prints, to even worse. To test that, I make two thick prints, one printed more slowly without cooling and the other printed twice as fast at max fan speed. I wash the build plate before the prints and measure the warping of all sides with a custom jig. I feel like the charts speak for itself. Regular PETGs had a significant warping with full fan speed, while modern PETGs showed no difference. It is also important to note that modern PETGs have better bed adhesion, and removing small pieces can take more effort even when the bed is cold. At the end of the day, the modern Polymakers and Bambus PETGs will produce prints with less warping, as we usually use at least some cooling when printing this type of material. I feel like a lot of people don't account for material shrinkage in slicer and wonder why their larger prints don't have, for example, the same distance between holes compared to the model. To measure the shrinkage, I print and measure how much undersized prints come out. For all of these tested PETG filaments, a good starting value would be around 99.7%. This slicer value will account for prints shrinking when they fully cool down. Another good value to know is how much fan speed to use on overhangs. This one unfortunately will heavily vary from printer and ambient temperatures, so it is just a reference point for what to expect. X1C has a pretty good part cooling, but my chamber temperatures were at 40 degrees Celsius. So here I have a sample printed with a part cooling fan at 90% speed for overhangs. They all looked quite decent and there was almost no difference. But when I tested a general print quality using the 3D Benchy, I saw that only Polymaker PETG had curling edges that caused the small defects at the front of the boat, so it might need a little bit more cooling than others. These days everyone likes to print fast. This means a way higher load on the extruder and even potential stripping and jamming of a filament if the required extrusion force is excessive. I'm really glad I built this specific machine to test that, as it revealed some interesting data in the past. On this X1C and the machine, I use the Conch Plus hot ends, which have a 25% longer melt zone compared to the stock bamboo hot end, which means it melts filament way better. The less force it takes to extrude, the better the filament flows. Comparing these four different PETGs reveals some great insights. Both regular type PETGs had almost identical required extrusion force. Meanwhile, Bamboo Lab's High Flow PETG showed why it's actually called High Flow, requiring the least force to extrude at all speeds. But the most interesting thing from this data is that Polymaker's High Speed PETG was right in the middle between the competition, the same as it was not fully glossy as regular PETG, but also not as matty as Bamboo PETG High Flow. It just sits in the middle. This suggests that Polymaker made a modern version of regular PETG and kept the advantages we love, like lay adhesion, and minimized some weak points. We still have to fully dry and keep our PETG this way if we expect strong and great quality prints, as otherwise we will be constantly swearing when they look like abominations with all the stringing. I won't lie, Bamboo PETG High Flow and its more matte look still attracts me a lot. But for prints that need to be tough and reliable with excellent and consistent lay adhesion, Polymaker's High Speed PETG is my new go-to filament. It still blows my mind how much abuse it can take before breaking along layers. If you want to try it out, make sure to use my affiliate link, as that supports all the testing I do. Hopefully this video was insightful about what to expect from different types of PETG. It is always great to have more choices. Make sure to like and share the video with others who seek this in-depth information. For the quick comparison sheets of filaments and all the testing data, you can find them on my Patreon page for people who support this very time-consuming work. Thank you so much. Well, that's all for me, and we'll see you next time.